Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, the Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. A flight is a series where I review the latest released or upcoming set or product for any and all cards that might have some form of impact in Commander. These episodes will be done under the assumption that you've already seen all of the cards in a set and isn't meant to be a spoiler video. This video is my own analysis on the cards I feel are most useful in a Commander format. A flight is a sampling of several brews, so I will be sampling the test cards from the Mystery Booster Convention Edition released on November 7th. Since I'm releasing this episode before Wizards has updated Gatherer with the images of these cards, I had to use the ones provided by Scryfall, which in turn used images taken by players during the first Mystery Booster draft ever at the convention. So I apologize if the image quality of some of these cards are incredibly lacking, but that's not Scryfall's fault. I am incredibly lucky for the existence of Scryfall, and I thank them for their hard work. I'm doing this analysis under the assumption that these aren't real Magic cards, as stated by Gavin Verhey in his article on the Mothership. I hope I'm not taking what he said out of context, but he states it there. Since these won't be legal for constructed formats, are only available at conventions while supplies last, and even then only legal in Mystery Booster drafts, I'm also assuming that these cards are going to be used by people for their cubes. Since you can put whatever you want in your cube, this episode of A Flight will be tailored in that aspect. So I'm fully aware that these cards aren't legal for Commander. As usual for my set and product reviews, these will be done from the point of view of the Commander format. So I'm only going to discuss those cards I think are worth including in Commander's decks and therefore worth considering for a cube. Especially since a lot of these cards have removal effects in very experimental ways that are actually not as good as cards already in existence. So instead of running those, you can just run something better. In any case, cards I omit are because they'll either cause too many headaches, aren't that good, or are just too out of left field. That being said, I'm releasing a full analysis of all 121 cards in document form on my Patreon for my patrons as thanks for supporting me. Back on topic. Since this is a review from a Commander player's perspective, I'm going to start off with the legendary creatures from this subset of cards. Once more, the weakest of all legendary creatures is the mono white one. Rough Underdog Champ is a 3-2 dog soldier with first strike and lifelink for 2 generic and 2 white. It makes all hound creatures be dog as well, so apparently there's going to now be a distinction between hounds and dogs like mice and rats. Anyways, they are so aware of this card being weak that it has an ability that pumps your dog creatures +1/+1 if you've lost a game this match. This is a hard pass for me. Cod Etlin's Sheath Envoy is a 2-3 Hamarid Warrior for 2 generic and 1 blue. It makes all lands islands in addition to their other types, which is great if you have a bunch of creatures with Island Walk. It's also a lord for Hamarids, Camarids, Cephalids, Nautilids, and Merfolk, which is odd because the Merfolk were at war with the Hamarids. I would have thought it gave +1/+1 to lobsters and crabs as well. Oh well, it can still work as a commander for more folk tribal or at least a support card in such a deck. Vazal the Complete is an artifact creature Phyrexian, the first creature with a Phyrexian as a type. It's a 7/7 with vigilance and trample for 3 generic and 3 green. We're already off to an amazing start since it's very doable in mono green. Not to be outdone, it also has the activated abilities of all other permanents on the battlefield. That includes planeswalkers, artifacts, lands, enchantments, etc. This is definitely a busted commander, so include it in your cube at your own risk. But I love this card, it's great. Zim, Mesmeric Lord is a 3-4 vampire wizard with flying and death touch for 1 generic, 1 blue, and 2 black. When it enters the battlefield, you have a sort of mini game with an opponent in order to see what to discard. It's a sort of press your luck game. You have the potential of discarding the best card in their hand or lose the chance to. It's pretty interesting to say the least. In any case, it has flying and death touch, so there's that. Luvak the Aberrant is a 3-4 mutant for 2 generic, 1 green and 1 blue. It has protection from modified creatures. What this means is that if a creature has any characteristic different than what's printed on the card, Luvak has protection from it. On top of that, you may put a +1/+1 counter on a creature controlled by a player at the end of their turn. This basically grants it protection from that creature. I love this card and I can see it doing lots of things in decks like Experiment Crash, Volrath the Shapestealer, and even Rayami First of the Fallen since it has a protection ability. Sliv-Mizzet Hivemind is pretty much a what if Niv-Mizzet Firemind were a Sliver Dragon kind of situation. It behaves like a post M14 Sliver giving all Slivers you control the same abilities as Niv-Mizzet Firemind. I could definitely see this going into a Slivers deck. If you have Slivers in your cube, then you'd definitely want to add this one. The final legend I'll be reviewing is Slivdrazi Monstrosity. It's an 8-8 for Kuberg that makes all Eldrazi you control into slivers. It also gives all slivers you control Devoid and Annihilator 1. There's already a sliver that makes slivers colorless, Ghost Flame Sliver, but this one is just for your slivers. As if giving your slivers Annihilator 1 wasn't enough, it also has an ability similar to Sliver Queen in that for 3 generic mana, it creates a 1-1 colorless Eldrazi sliver creature that can sacrifice itself for 1 colorless mana. You could combine this with abilities from cards like Hearthstone and the like in order to make infinite tokens and really make a mess of things. So I can definitely see this going into sliver decks. It's good enough to be the commander of a sliver deck, but for a sliver deck, I'd rather have Sliver Overlord or the first sliver as the commander for a sliver's deck. With the legendary creatures out of the way, let's continue with the rest of my picks by color. We're starting off strong with the white cards thanks to Banding Sliver. A very straightforward old school sliver, this one is a 3-3 for 3 generic and 2 white that gives banding to all slivers. It might have been scratched when Wizards decided to eliminate banding after Weatherlight since slivers made their debut in the following block, Tempest. Or, they might have just created it specifically for this set and made a sliver with one of the few key words to be used with them. But who knows where these test cards came from. In any case, not to ruin any surprises, I'm going to give an explanation of banding in a future video. For now, if you do understand how banding works, the obvious potential home for this card is in a sliver's deck. So if your cube is tribal and want something different, feel free to add this one in. Enroll in the Coalition makes you a flag bearer. What this means is that if an opponent casts a spell that can target you, it has to target you. This might be great at stopping opponents from casting cards like Time Warp, but those cards are few and far between when compared to cards that hurt its target. There's a reason the Coalition flag art has a guy with an arrow in his back. Since it's white, you can definitely include it in a Bad Christmas Zedru the Greathearted deck and just donate it to a hapless opponent. 5 Kids in a Trench Coat counts as 5 creatures for spells that care about such things. So if Gaia's Cradle needed to get any more busted, here's one way of making it more busted. Or basically in any deck that cares about a number of creatures. For example, if you only sacrifice 5 Kids in a Trench Coat to Emrakul's Evangel, you'd create 6 Eldrazi horror tokens for the price of 2 creatures. If you do something like that in an Asmira Holy Avenger deck, then she would get 6 plus 1 counters at the end of the turn in which you activated that ability, all for sacrificing those 2 creatures. The Kids alone would give Whatley Radiant Champion 5 additional loyalty counters when she activates her plus 1 ability. There's just a whole bunch of hijinxes you could do with it, and it seems pretty fun. Frontier Explorer is a great turn 1 drop in Limit Draft. However, its activated ability is iffy in Commander since it's technically a wish effect. However, in a Commander Cube draft, it's technically doable since whatever you drafted that isn't included in your deck is considered your sideboard. So, even though wish effects can have you look for any card in your collection, and this is something that doesn't work in Commander games per se, in a draft environment, like Commander Cube, wish effects should allow you to seek out cards at least in your sideboard. In this case, since it's a basic planes you're tutoring for. In Cube Draft, there should be a theoretical limitless amount of basic lands from which players can use to build their decks. In that case, this creature can be used as intended in a draft environment. That being said, this is great ramping for white, something it desperately needs. This card also goes great in landfall decks because you can guarantee a landfall trigger each turn. Or you can combo it with cards like Knight of the Reliquary. You wish in the planes and then sacrifice it to find whatever land you actually need. Sarah's Wings is unique in that it can target either a creature or a player, granting them flying until end of turn. If a player has flying, then they can't be attacked by creatures without flying. I can easily see this card crossing over into normal magic if only slightly tweaked. For example, it can say choose one. Target creature gains flying until end of turn, or prevent all damage dealt to target player by creatures without flying this turn. This card is a great way to escape combat damage from a horde of creatures coming your way if they don't have flying. You can also use it to save another player, so it's also a great political tool. Scale Destruction is a modular board wipe similar to Austere Command, since you get to choose what's being destroyed. Honestly, the only nutty part about the card is the reference to creatures based on size instead of power, so I don't think that's something that'll become official. But this is also a card that can very easily exist in normal magic by just using what it has as reminder text instead of sizing the creatures. Although it costs 4 generic and 2 white, it's a great card to have in many different decks. For example, if you're playing weenies and the board is full of huge creatures, you can just choose both modes that aren't creatures with total power 4 or less. Stack of Paperwork cantrips when it enters the battlefield, so that's already a plus. What I love about this enchantment is that it reverts games back to how they were in the times of Mog Fanatic. For those of you who don't know, back in the day, damage went onto the stack. Thanks to Mach Fanatic abusing this rule, it was subsequently changed. What happened was that I could attack or block with Mach Fanatic, then, in response to the damage, sacrifice it with its ability to deal 1 damage to that creature. Thus, the creature would be receiving 2 damage total from it. That's no longer how it works, obviously. However, this enchantment reverts to that. So if, for example, you have a 6-6 blocked by another 6-6, with the combat damage on the stack, you could bounce, blink, tuck, etc. your creature in response, and the other creature would still receive the 6 damage. Wow, it's been a really long time since I've had to worry about those interactions. So if you reminisce about these kinds of interactions, then this card is definitely for you. When Wizened Arbiter enters the battlefield, you can wish for a white card you own from outside the game and exchange it with a card in your hand. This is another wish type effect which will be considered in the same way as the other wish type effects I have discussed so far and will hitherto discuss. It won't work as intended in normal commander games, but if you build a commander cube, then it can work as intended, at least in a draft environment where wishes can only fetch things from your sideboard. If you have a house rule with your playgroup, especially for wishes, then just do as your house rule states. If you're able to repeatedly use this ability, then it can get pretty busted though. You're in command seems like it belongs in a commander cube or commander deck more so than a normal draft environment. However, as the release notes clearly state, this spell grants you a commander even if you're not in a commander game. So as far as this card is concerned, it behaves just like a commander in an EDH game. You can send it to the command zone as a replacement effect for leaving zones, it gets a commander tax, etc. The whole shebang. Another clarification is that changing your commander won't affect your deck. So if you make a Bane of Balaged your commander, you don't have to change the contents of your deck in any way during your game or anything. It simply replaces your commander. On that note, if you switch your commander while your previous commander was still in the command zone, you won't be able to cast it afterwards. It's stuck there for the rest of the game. So take that into consideration when casting this spell. Another crazy thing is that if you make a creature represented by multiple creatures, such as a melded creature, an augmented creature, or a creature mashed with Grusilda Monster Masher, then each of those creatures becomes your commander, sort of like the partner mechanic. That means that if you cast this on your Brisella Voice of Nightmares, then both Bruna the Fading Light and Gisela the Broken Blade become your commander, similar to having any partner pair in your command zone. Also, this allows you to make any animated permanent your commander. If you somehow made an artifact, enchantment, or a planeswalker into a creature and then targeted it with this spell, it's now your commander. Keep in mind that you can't cast lands, so if you animate a land and make it your commander, you can't play it from the command zone later on. I love this idea, but I really hope this isn't Wizard's way of pleasing commander players with getting commanders we've been wanting for a long time. I don't want to run a Nephilim and then cast this on it to make it my commander. I'd like legendary, functional reprints of the 5 Nephilim. If nothing else, then so that players who play them as a special consideration in their playgroup can simply swap them out for the legal version and have no qualms wherever they go. I know I'm dying for a functional reprint of Ink Treader Nephilim. The creature would just have to have a different name and be legendary. That's it. That's literally the only thing that needs to be done to please a bunch of people. Hopefully we get that in future Commander products, being as it could have been done in Commander 2016, but wasn't. Alright, ranting aside, let's discuss the blue cards. Animate Spell is an R with Flash that enchants an instant or sorcery on the stack. This isn't the first time this type of effect exists in Magic. Spellweaver Volute does a similar thing but with an instant card in a graveyard. This goes with my initial comment about this set being a mashup of Future Sight and Unglued, but I'll give my opinions on this subset as a whole near the end of the video. Reading the release notes explains how it works a bit more, but it's pretty straightforward. When you animate an instant or sorcery from the stack, it becomes a creature instead, so it doesn't resolve. In other words, whatever it was going to do doesn't happen. When it becomes a creature, if X was used to cast that spell, X is not 0. It's whatever was paid for the X, unless of course X was 0. If Animate Spell leaves the battlefield, the controller of the spell it was enchanting can choose to cast the spell. If not, then the spell is sacrificed as a creature and goes to the graveyard without resolving. I think that this is a very interesting concept and, if done correctly within the rules, can be achieved. It's pretty intuitive except for working around some potential timing and typing issues since instants and sorceries aren't permanents. That being said, this card goes great in an Enchantments Matters deck as essentially a counterspell on an enchantment. It can also go great in a blinking deck as a way to consistently animate spells in order to get rid of them. Command the Shaft is an instant that allows you to look through an opponent's sideboard and cast a card from it without paying its mana cost. It's exiled afterwards. This wouldn't be the first time cards mention the sideboard. Jester's Sombrero is an artifact that allows you to remove any three cards from a player's sideboard for the remainder of the match. Obviously, these effects have no function in a constructed commander game, but when drafting a commander cube, they do. If you're drafting, then you'll have leftover cards. Any leftover cards not in your deck become your sideboard. So Command the Shaft essentially lets you cast any spell from a player's pool of leftover cards for just 6 mana. It's a bit overcosted, but has the potential of being incredibly powerful. Maybe a player ended up drafting a bomb they couldn't play because of not being able to fit it in the deck or because it wasn't in the correct color identity. Then you could see through their remaining card pool and cast anything for free. It's definitely a great card in a commander queue. Control win condition has power and toughness equal to the number of turns its controller has taken that game. This is obviously tongue-in-cheek since everyone knows that control players make games drag on to what feels like forever. However, in commander games, which usually take over an hour anyways and have so many turns, this card will definitely be a huge beater. Making it unblockable so late in the game can definitely take someone out of the match. This can easily find a home in a Sun Quan Lord of Wu deck or when comboed with Deep Channel Mentor. Since it has Shroud, you can't target it, but global unblockability is possible. And an unblockable 10-10 on turn 10 is definitely something that can end a player right then and there. Innocuous Insect cantrips when you cast it. Since it has buyback, you can pay that in order to return it to your hand. So it's a bit expensive if you want to cast it consistently to draw a card. But in the right deck, you can abuse that ability. For example, Chilean Teller of Tales is definitely a commander that can abuse creatures like this one. Loopy Lobster is an interesting creature in that you can use it with tap hijinxes such as crewing vehicles or paying for convoke costs in order to cycle through its stages. When it gets to stage 2, you can have creatures enter the battlefield to give it +1/+1 counters. That way, as it reverts to stage 1, it still retains its counters. I think this is a unique design since it's a cyclical level up. However, you might want to have a 4-sided die at hand in order to easily indicate which stage it's on. Recyclo Bird is a 1-1 bird with flying for 1 blue mana, that when it dies, it puts a flying counter on target creature you control. What this means is that it gives flying to that creature permanently, well, at least as an effect that doesn't wear off at end of turn. This is similar to cards like Riding the Delu Horse, where the creature gains +2/+2 permanently, but it's not a +2/+2 counter, and it also gains horsemanship permanently. Since it's hard to keep track of these abilities that don't last until end of turn, my guess is that's what the quote-unquote counter is for. However, since it's a counter, it also interacts with abilities from cards like Giant Fan and Every Thingamajig version A. You can tap these down to move a counter of one type from one permanent to another. This means that you can move around that flying counter to other creatures. These are odd things that basically occur in Silver Borderland, which is probably why granting keywords with counters like they increases or increase in power and toughness, like +1/+1 and -1/-1 counters, hasn't been done yet, at least as of the recording of this video. It's still an interesting card that can go in decks like Edric's Spymaster of Trest if you're running an evasive weenie build. It also transfers its flying ability to any one of your other creatures when it dies, so there are some decks that can run it. Time Sidewalk might seem like a horribly overcosted extra turn spell. However, if you're lucky enough to have it in your opening hand, you can exile it in order to create 4 Time Walk card tokens and shuffle it into your deck. The release notes state that unlike a normal token, a token card doesn't cease to exist in a zone other than the battlefield. It's both a token and a card. It can move between zones any number of times and continues to exist for the rest of the game. Also, if a token card is put into a hidden zone, you must use a supplementary token card with a magic card back to represent it. Since these don't exist yet, you may need to be creative. In this case, I would recommend just using any marketing card and sleeving it up with the same sleeves as your deck and shuffle them in. If they're the only cards like that in your deck, then obviously drawing or casting that card is indicative of being a time walk for all effects and purposes of the game. The release notes also indicate that for effects that look for or modify the creation of tokens, creating token cards isn't the same as creating tokens. This means that doubling season won't give you 8 time walk token cards. I think it's interesting and it's probably not that broken in a 100 card singleton format like Commander. Sure, 4 time walks in the deck is a bit powerful, but how hard would you have to mulligan in order to get it in your opening hand? Even if you find it mulliganing down to something like 3 or 2, how are you even going to play the game? And if the table sees you successfully exile that spell and create 4 time walks, you're definitely becoming the arch enemy since turn zero. Truth or Dare is a sorcery for 1 generic and 2 blue where an opponent has to choose between Truth or Dare. If they choose Truth, then they have to keep their hand revealed for the remainder of the match. However, if they choose Dare, then their deck is milled all the way down until there's 10 cards remaining. Casting this on a third turn in a commander game will no doubt make that player choose Truth. However, if I'm targeted by that spell and I have Laboratory Maniac in play, I might be brave and choose Dare. This spell can also be used in conjunction with turn controlling effects like Emrakul, the Promised End, or Soren Markov in order to force that opponent to choose Dare. It's a bit roundabout, but no more so than any other two-card combo. Visitor from Planet Q harkens back to when Marrow wanted to make instant creatures, but the rules people said that it wouldn't be possible with the current ruling, so they created the Flash keyword instead. So basically, this creature gives Flash to all your creatures, but also gives them the instant type as well. This makes all your creatures trigger its second ability, allowing you to loot for one. You can also trigger it when casting artifact enchantments. Keep in mind that Legendary, Snow, etc. are super types and thus don't count for its ability. This isn't like the adventure mechanic though. It just makes your creatures have an additional type. It doesn't make them have a different ability. However, this also allows for some interesting interactions. For example, you can technically imprint it on Isochron Scepter. I tweeted Gavin Verhey and he forwarded to Eli Schifrin and he confirms that if you imprint Visitor from Planet Q onto Isochron Scepter, it will create tokens that are copies of it when you activate the scepter. This means that it should also be true for other instant creatures of converted mana cost 2 or less. So if you have the alien and scepter in play, you can imprint things like Stormcrow onto it since it'd be an instant creature. This interaction is nuts. Alright, let's move on to the black cards. Bone Rattler is a 4-4 skeleton for 3 generic and 2 black. When it's put into the graveyard from anywhere, you exile it. When you do, you create 4 reassembling skeleton token cards and put them into your graveyard. This effect is similar to the aforementioned Time Sidewalk. This can lead to some interesting effects. For example, this would allow Crypt of Agadeem to tap for 4 more black mana just from a single card's effect. Either way, this gives you 4 additional creatures you can use in an aristocrat deck like Taste of Karloff or in stacks decks like Mazurek Kral Death Priest or Prosh Sky Raider of Kerr, to name a few. Buried Ogre is a 6-4 zombie ogre for 1 generic and 3 black. You may begin the game with it in your graveyard. If you do, you lose 1 life. This is practically negligible in a commander match due to the high starting life. If you manage to have a way to cast Exhume during your first turn, then you're starting the game with a 6-4, which is nothing to scoff at. So this card can definitely go into a Graveyard Matters deck or a Reanimator deck such as Caridor Ghost Chieftain or the Mimeoplasm. It also has 3 black mana symbols in its mana cost, so it also helps black devotion decks. Celestine Cave Witch creates 2 1-1 black insect creature tokens when entering the battlefield. When the witch attacks, you may sacrifice an insect. If you do, you curse the defending player. What this mechanic does is create a black aura curse enchantment token attached to that player. The token has, at the beginning of your upkeep, you lose 1 life. I feel like this is definitely a card that could have made the cut in Throne of Eldraine. They've already been aura enchantment tokens in the past, like Esther the Mask's mask tokens. The way it's worded on Celestine Cave Witch is similar to other token creating mechanics like Investigate, where the keyworded ability creates a specific token tied to the mechanic. This creature would be interesting in a cursed deck as well as an Enchantment Matters deck or just a slow bomb deck. Corrupted Key gives your creatures Menace and Death Touch as long as it's tapped. It doesn't have an untap clause, so it will untap during each of your untap phases. However, in conjunction with cards like Clock of Omens or Shimmer Dragon, which have abilities that tap down artifacts, you could definitely use this to your advantage. It doesn't work on its own, but it can still be very useful in an Artifacts Matters deck. So you can definitely slot it in Alila Artful Provocateur or Breya Ethereum Shaper. Everlasting Lich is a 4-0 zombie for 2 generic and 3 black. I'm surprised it's not a zombie wizard since it's a lich. It can block, but it can't die. What this means is that it has indestructible, can't be sacrificed, and doesn't go to the graveyard as a state-based action for having 0 toughness. Basically, you can only get rid of it by exiling, tucking, or bouncing. This reminds me of Xenagos Ascended, but a bit weaker since Xenagos can't even leave the battlefield, so it goes beyond not dying. This Lich can go great in pretty much any mono black deck since it's a 4-0 for 5, which isn't that bad since it literally cannot die. So you're only paying 1 extra beyond its power for that ability. Gunk Slug is yet another card that generates token cards. What's interesting about this effect is that it slows down opponents since you're adding cards to their library that are pretty useless. You're literally adding gunk to their deck and slowing them down. The token isn't entirely useless since they can draw off of it, but for a whopping 4 mana. However, some decks might have a cycling or discarding strategy, so don't put these gunk tokens into their deck. It's definitely an interesting card. It's also a 2-3 for 3 mana, which isn't that bad. I would play it by profusely blinking it. If you can blink it multiple times a turn, you'll be filling an opponent's library with literal garbage and they won't be able to do much. Just make sure they're not running Battle of Wits, although that'd be beyond hilarious. Large Pox is basically a souped-up Smallpox. With all the things being sacrificed in a multiplayer game, this card is crazy in a Korvold Faker's King deck. It's even crazier in a Mazarek Crawl Death Priest deck. The amount of triggers Mazarek is going to make will be nuts in a 4-player match. One with Death is an instant that costs 1 black and has you lose the game. This might seem like a useless card, but if you give me a chance, I'll make it work. All you need is Naughty Nice, Mindslaver, and Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth. First, you activate Mindslaver to take control of an opponent during their next turn. Then, you use the Nice side of the split card to search your library for one with Death and put it into that opponent's hand. The Urborg is just to make sure you're able to generate black mana when you take over that player's next turn. When it's their turn and they're under your control, just cast one with Death. You might not be able to concede while controlling another player, but you can cast one with Death. Spellmorph Raise Dead is an instant for 1 black that returns a creature from your graveyard to your hand. It also has Spellmorph for 1 black. Spellmorph is basically Morph, but for instants and sorceries instead of creatures. Keep in mind that you can't cast non-creature spells or lands that are manifested or face down for whatever reason. But this is possible if the instant or sorcery has Spellmorph. I can definitely see this card in a deck like Kadena Slinking Sorcerer. Sunimret is just Terminus backwards, not just in name but in function as well, because it's black and has Reverse Miracle. What Reverse Miracle does is that it allows you to cast this spell for its miracle cost if it's on the bottom of your library when you're searching through it. This is a pretty busted spell considering that you can very easily bottom deck things with cards like Epitaph Golem and its ilk. Then, with any tutor spell or even cracking a fetch land, you can then cast it for just 1 black to exile all creatures. It requires a couple of hoops to jump through in order to abuse its reverse miracle cost, but for its normal cost and exiling all creatures, it's still an amazing ability in a commander game. It's essentially a strictly better black Final Judgment. Swarm of Locusts is a 1-1 flying insect locust for 1 generic and 1 black. Whenever it attacks, it gets +1/+0 until end of turn for each locust you control. You might think this card won't be that good in a Mystery Booster draft since Cloud Post and Glimmer Post aren't even in the set. However, if you analyze this card deeper, then the implications for this creature become quite clear. It sets the precedent of a creature having the Locust subtype. This means that in an environment where Swarm of Locusts is legal, or if you have it included in your commander cube, these Locust lands have the potential of becoming incredibly busted. For example, if you have a field full of changelings, or if you have Conspiracy in play with Locust chosen as the creature type, then Cloud Post can tap for an insane amount of colorless mana. Underdark Beholder is crazy. First off, it's a 6-6 for 6 mana. Its ability that can cheat you spells triggers when it attacks and not when it deals combat damage, so before it's blocked and loses Ice Stock counters, you get to use its ability. This can go in many spell slinging decks or enchantments matters decks. Being able to cheat out an Expropriate or Insurrection is no joke. There are also plenty of ways to make it unblockable if you want to ensure it keeps its counters. A curiosity to note is that although Beholder is a nod to Dungeons & Dragons, it's not the first card Wizards had considered with that creature type. In Inquest number 41, you can find a cutout card called Beholder. Although I'd love to get into more details on Magic rarities and obscure stuff, this video is already a bit long, so I'll save that for another time. Zyru's Spectre is like your typical Spectres that force defending players to discard a card upon getting hit by it, but in this case, the defending player can challenge you. When they do, you can show them 2 black cards in your hand. If you do, they have to discard 2 cards. Having an opponent discard 2 cards at the cost of revealing 2 cards from your hand isn't that bad, and on a 2-2 flyer for 4 mana isn't that bad either. This could probably go in a Haunt of Hightower or Nath of the Guiltleaf discard deck. Yawgmoth's Testament allows you to play face-up cards you own from exile. As if that weren't busted enough, until end of turn, whenever a card would be put into your graveyard or exile from anywhere this turn, you put it on the bottom of your library instead. This card is insane. Retrieving something from exile is so far only possible with Rift's Reaper and Pull from Eternity. This card is definitely a nod to Yawgmoth's Will, a card so broken it's banned everywhere except Vintage and Commander, and that's only because in both formats you can only play one copy of it in your deck. It's more common for things to be in your graveyard than exile, but being able to cast any face-up card from your exile is powerful, since most powerful spells exile themselves after being cast. Not only that, but the second part of the spell means that any spell you cast after resolving Yawgmoth's Testament will go to the bottom of your library instead of your graveyard. You can also infinitely mill yourself since the cards wouldn't go to the graveyard, so this can be broken in decks like Sidisi Brute Tyrant or Sir Conrad the Grim. This is essentially an insane card that you can add to your cube if it's leaning closer to the power side of the spectrum. Now that we're done with the black cards, on to the red ones. We're halfway to the end, so thanks for your patience. I also want to thank all my patrons for their continued support as well as the support of my subscribers and viewers. Your comments, subscriptions, sharing my videos, etc. really helps my channel grow, so I just wanted to take this moment to thank you all. Alright, let's continue on. Bombardment converts all cards you don't have onto the battlefield into a red sorcery named Missile that costs 1 red mana and has this card deals 2 damage to any target. This means that if you had Thrumming Stone in play, any missile you cast will trigger it, thus casting every single card in your deck. This is essentially a 2-card oops I win combo in any mono red deck or deck with a red color identity. High Troller reduces all spells and abilities by 2 generic if they're targeting. Then, those targets are chosen at random. For example, if I cast a Lightning Bolt, its target is chosen at random from amongst all possible legal targets. If I activate Safe Haven, then the creature exiled is at random. Keep in mind that although random, the target is chosen at random from legal targets. So in the case of Safe Haven, only my creatures are chosen at random. If you love adding chaotic elements to your cube, this is definitely something for you. Impatient Iguana is a 2-1 Lizard Wizard with haste for 1 generic and 1 red. If it's in your opening hand and you're not the starting player, you may reveal it. If you do, you become the starting player. This card is similar to Power Play in that it changes who is the starting player. It's also similar to other cards that trigger at turn 0 like the Ley Lines and Gemstone Caverns. This is a great card in a multiplayer game since the first player usually gets all the benefits of starting since they also draw a card during their first draw step. Lazier Goblin is basically a shock on a body. However, it can't attack or block unless you pay its motivate cost. You can only motivate as a sorcery, so if you want to attack or block with it, you have to pay 3 generic and 1 red. Motivating it might not even be so necessary. Being a shock on a body is very useful in and of itself. Maybe you can slot this into your Krenko Mob Boss or Pashalik Mons Goblin Tribal deck. These decks care about the quantity and not quality of goblins necessarily. Lightning Colt is another instant creature, so even though it doesn't have flash, it can be cast at instant speed. True to its namesake, it deals 3 damage to any target when it enters the battlefield. The casting cost might seem a bit steep, but it's a 3-3 with 2 abilities for 5 mana. It can go in any kind of deck from Bounce to Blink to even a Horse Tribal deck with Princess Twilight Sparkle at the helm. In any case, it's probably the remnants of R&D testing before flash was formalized as Josh Lee Kwai's favorite keyword. Mana Abundance is a world enchantment for 2 generic and 1 wet. The way a world enchantment works is that only one permanent of the world super type can be on the battlefield at a time. Anyways, this card is nuts. Whenever a player would add a mana, instead all players add that mana. If your deck loves doing things outside of your turn, then your opponents will be giving you the mana to do so every turn. This might turn them off from adding mana to their mana pool just to prevent you from getting it. So it's still a win-win. However, if you don't have dastardly plans for running this card, it also goes great in group hug decks like Kainaios and Tiro of Miletus. If it's helping other players out more than hurting each other, you might get Sanctuary for a long time during the match. Plane Quake is a sorcery for X generic and 1 red that deals X damage to each creature without flying and each planeswalker. If X is 10 or more, you open the Uncovered Cavern plot booster. For those who don't know, a plot booster is a concept used in Legacy-style board games. Legacy-style board games are games that are permanently changed and edited as you play them. For example, you might punch out parts of a board or add stickers to some places, etc. In any case, these things don't exist in Magic yet, so it would appear that Wizards didn't learn their lesson from the contraptions in Future Sight. However, maybe this is something they'll create further along down the line. I think that plot boosters could be separate booster packs that don't contain cards that would work on their own in a Magic game, similarly to how conspiracies and contraptions don't do anything on their own unless the game you're playing is meant to incorporate them. In any case, for the moment, this is just a sorcery speed magma quake for one red mana less. Queue of Beetles changes the way the stack works. It goes from Philo order to FIFO order. The stack is already complex as it is, and this makes it even more complex since it changes what we're all accustomed to. That being said, this creature basically makes control effects worthless. If I cast a spell and then an opponent counters it, my spell would resolve first and then their counterspell fizzles because the order of the stack changed and would thus have no target. This is bonkers. This makes it so that it's not worth it to respond to most things on the stack since the first thing would resolve first. That being said, it can still be abused even further. If an opponent casts an overloaded Cyclonic Rift, I can flash in a bunch of things. They will resolve after the Cyclonic Rift, thus entering the battlefield afterwards, so it does have its merit. On top of that, the creature is a 3-3 with haste for 4 mana, so it's got decent stats too. Siege Elemental is a 6-6 elemental with trample for 4 generic and 2 red. Right off the bat, it's got good stats. I love its abilities too. Untapped creatures can block and tapped creatures can block. This reminds me of Masako the Humorless. However, Masako only lets your tapped creatures block. Siege Elemental not only makes it so all tapped creatures can block, but that untapped creatures can't block. This is an amazing card in an aggro deck. If I ever get around to designing a commander cube, this is definitely a card I'm slotting in. Throat Wolf is a 3-1 wolf with Firstest Strike for 1 generic and 2 red. Firstest Strike means that it deals combat damage before creatures with First Strike, and assumingly Double Strike as well. It can also be cast during an opponent's combat phase, so it has a kind of conditional flash as well. If that weren't enough, it gives each opponent an additional combat phase each turn where only Throat Wolf can attack. This card is crazy good if you can give it vigilance as well as other boons. For those not in the know, this card is a throwback to a very old article in the Duelist number 9 about the Throat Wolf, a fantasy card discussed there. This is why it has Summon Wolf instead of Creature Wolf. Notice the similarities between the cards. Although they're very different, Wizards really went deep into obscure Easter egg territories with this card. But with the Beholder, that's a discussion for another time. Tumult the Chaotic has effects that cast already existing magic cards at random, so it helps if you have at least a copy of these cards at hand to make it easier and faster to know what he's having you cast. Since they're chosen at random, it also helps since you can shuffle them and choose one seemingly at random. This would be the most efficient way of doing this. Three-sided dice aren't easy to come by, but that's what I would use along with Scryfall. In any case, his plus one has you casting either Ignorant Bliss, Crack the Earth, or Blazing Volley, chosen at random. His minus three has you casting either Seething Song, Dance with Devils, or Flame Break at random. And finally, his minus six has you casting Helion Eruption, Insurrection, or Warp World at random. I don't think this is a bad version of Tybalt, and it definitely shows R&D testing concepts such as copying spells by name rather than writing out their effects on a card. I can see how this might be efficient, but I'm a bit on the fence as to how I feel about it. I feel like this is just a worse Urza Academy Headmaster, which is a great Planeswalker to add to a cube, by the way. Transcantation basically transforms an instant or sorcery spell on the stack into Lightning Bolt. This is definitely an interesting concept since it's along the same vein as Turn to Frog. A lot of these test cards seem to mention turning spells into others or creating copies of spells that already exist. As is, I think this spell is very useful in red decks since it gets rid of many spells red normally couldn't get rid of. It can get rid of counterspells, wraths, board wipes, and even an overloaded Cyclonic Rift, so it gives red something it wouldn't normally have in its arsenal. Trial and Error is not a tribal instant elemental, it's an elemental instant fire. This means that if you're playing this card, there is now a new super type elemental that is different from the creature type elemental. This also means that fire is an elemental subtype. Getting that confusion out of the way, what this spell does is that if it were to be countered, or if it fizzles, then you may copy it and you may choose new targets for that copy. This concept is amazing since it's almost guaranteed that this spell will find a target. We're almost at the final stretch. Moving on to the green cards, we have Bear with Set's Mechanic, which is a 2-2 bear with Vigilance and Aggressive for 1 generic and 1 green. Aggressive is a key word in which you get an additional combat phase after the first one where only creatures with aggressive can attack. However, this only triggers if you control a creature with aggressive before your first combat phase, as specified in the release notes. I think this ability is interesting, and if nothing else, this card will do wonders in an Ayula, Queen of Monks, Bears, Bear tribal deck. Experiment 5 is a 1-1 Bear Snake Mutant for 1 green mana, and for 1 and Z, you can put a +1/+2 counter on it. Z is apparently a placeholder for some new potential mana symbol, similar to how the Snowflake mana symbol means you have to pay it with mana from a snow source. Z means that you have to pay with mana from a source that can produce two or more mana colors. It's not a bad card since it can grow to be huge in the right deck, especially with Proliferate. Maybe in a janky, pure imaginative rascal and toothy imaginary friend deck. Generated Horizons has a pretty cool ability since it creates a land token. Although green doesn't have a need for further ramp in this format, green is Gavin Verhey's favorite color and this enchantment helps green ramp even further. Not only does it help green ramp harder, but those tokens are also going to trigger landfall. Not only that, but a spell like Second Harvest will duplicate those forest tokens. If you have Bruticlad, Teltr, Engineer in play, then you can have all your tokens become a copy of those forests for even larger and ridiculous mana boost. Guerrilla Tactics is a great card. Not only is a 2-2 creature token for 2 mana on an instant more than fair, if you're playing at a table where someone forces you to discard a card, you can discard it and get double the tokens. Definitely a great card for a commander cube since it can go in a spell slinging deck, a token deck, a weenie deck, etc. Growth Charm is another card referencing other cards by name. You can either have this spell be a rampant growth, giant growth, or regrowth. They all have their uses, but the most niche one is probably giant growth. Paying 3 mana for giant growth is not something I'm willing to do unless it's going to win me the game. That being said, an instant speed, rampant growth, or regrowth is definitely a plus. So paying 1 mana extra in order to have those spells at instant speed is definitely something I can get behind. Inspirational Antelope has Legacy, which is an ability where you have to choose a keyword or ability before the game starts and write it on the card. Its other ability is that spells with that keyword or ability you cast cost 1 generic mana less to cast. The possibilities are pretty much endless with this card. Do you write Annihilator on it in order to make Eldrazi even cheaper to cast? I probably wouldn't write on the actual card though. I'd maybe write on a note and keep it nearby for when I'm finished with the draft. It's not like this card is going to be printed to oblivion, so I wouldn't have the luxury of straight up inking it. The legacy word is probably referencing legacy games where you're permanently changing it, so writing on the card is a permanent change. But again, I would advise against that. Inner Planner Brushwag is a 6-4 Brushwag with Vigilance and Haste for 3 generic and 1 green. It also has Interplanner. This means that if it were to enter the battlefield, it enters the Interplanner battlefield instead. Players can't control creatures on the Interplanner battlefield. This is where its final ability becomes relevant. Whenever a player attacks with a creature of power 4 or greater, this creature attacks that same target. This means that you might get attacked with it even if it's yours. I think it's an interesting ability, but in a format like Commander where everyone has fatties, this more than likely might end up attacking you or your planeswalkers more than you'd like. That being said, it could also be a political card. You can use it so that when your opponents are attacking each other, it attacks with them too. I can see this going into Omarisi Breaker of the Coil deck. If all of your opponent's creatures are goaded, they won't be able to attack you anyways, but having them attack each other means that the Brushwag will also be attacking them. Having Vigilance means that it'll always get to attack as long as it's alive too. One thing to note is that this is the second creature of the Brushwag type. Krosan Adaptation is an R with Storm. This means that the copies enter the battlefield as tokens. You can also choose new copies for those tokens. This aura gives Enchanted Creature +1/+0 and Vigilance. This is interesting and I find it similar to Super Duper Death Ray, where an instant gets Trample. In a spell slinging deck, you can very easily make your commander huge and swing in for a lethal. Since it's getting pumped with auras, the pump won't go away at end of turn. Definitely an interesting card. Marrow's Gone Nuts doubles the effect of anything that doubles. True to its namesake, this card is nuts. On its own, the card is only good for increasing devotion to green. However, it quadruples any effect that explicitly refers a player to double something or an effect that literally says double that much, twice as many, or similarly worded expressions. So, if there are effects where the outcome is the double of something but the effect doesn't expressly say so, then it won't count for this enchantment. Combined with cards like Doubling Season, Wound Reflection, Unbound Flourishing, etc., and you have some serious arithmetic to do. If you do include it in your cube, beware of the power unless your cube is built with power in mind. Plain Merge Elf is a 3-3 Elf Warrior with Landship and Kinfall for 4 generic and 1 green. These abilities are basically swaps of Landfall and Kinship. Landship means that at the beginning of your upkeep, you look at the top card of your library and may reveal it if it's a land card. If you do, you create a 1-1 green Elf Warrior creature token. Kinfall means that whenever a creature enters the battlefield under your control, if it shares a creature type with Plain Merge Elf, then creatures you control get +1/+1 until end of turn. I can definitely see this card going in many decks. It creates tokens and it pumps your creatures. Warrior and Elf is a very common creature type, so this can definitely go in tribal cubes as well as tribal commanders. Soulmates is an aura you can use as a form of removal. If you enchant one of your creatures and one of an opponent's fatties, you can sacrifice your creature or kill it some other way in order to kill the harder to destroy fatty. Or, you can just stay inside of the box and just use it to give two of your creatures +1/+1 and Hexproof instead. Alright, let's move on to the colorless spells. Lantern of Undersight lets you draw cards from the bottom of your library instead of the top of it. With so many spells and effects that let you bottom cards in any order, this artifact has the potential for some seriously broken things. One card that comes to mind is Bow of Nylea. You can put up to 4 cards from your graveyard to the bottom of your library in any order. That means that you can draw into them however you wish with the lantern. Again, include it in your cube with caution. Mirrored Lotus is a 0-costed artifact with Reflect 0. This means that as it enters the battlefield, each opponent may pay 0. If they do, they create copies of Mirrored Lotus except for that ability. Its other ability is true to its namesake since you can tap it and exile it to add 3 mana of any one color to your mana pool. Any form of Black Lotus is powerful in some form of another, but at least this one makes it fair since anyone can use it. So this can definitely find a home in group hug decks. Pything Spyglass is clearly a reference to Pithing Needle and Sorceress Spyglass. As it enters the battlefield, you name a keyword ability or ability word. Then all cards in all zones lose that keyword ability or ability word and all text tied to that ability. This can be pretty brutal against certain decks. You can use it to remove Hexproof, Shroud, or Indestructible from the game. You can even combo it with the aforementioned Mirror Lotus and take its Reflect ability away so that only you get the benefit of the card. This is a great and malleable hoser that can go in any deck, so it's a great addition to a cube. Piercing Angel is a 4/4 artifact creature angel with flying and indestructible for 8 generic mana. When it enters the battlefield, you exile all artifacts that aren't colorless. That's pretty specific, but if you have enough of them in your cube, then that ability becomes relevant. Whenever it deals combat damage to a player, you get an emblem that prevents you from losing the game. Instead of losing, your life total becomes 20, you shuffle your graveyard into your library, you lose all poison counters, and then you lose the emblem. This is definitely an interesting take on cards like Platinum Angel. The only way for an opponent to remove that emblem is to eliminate you from the game. However, if you have multiple emblems, you only lose one to its effect, so it's almost like extra lives. That being said, these emblems don't prevent you from losing if an opponent wins the game through some other method. That does it for the single-colored cards and colorless spells. Now let's check out the multicolored spells. Personal Decoy is crazy broken. Sure, it costs 7 mana, but that's not something difficult to cast in a commander game. It enters the battlefield with a number of loyalty counters equal to your life. On top of that, you can't be attacked. The only downside is that it's exiled if it would leave the battlefield. Its +1 gains you 1 life, but its -4 draws you a card. In a commander game, this is basically card draw every turn and you can't get attacked. Include this in your cube if you don't mind the power level. Abeon Luvian Usurper is another busted planeswalker but works opposite to the aforementioned duck one. Your life becomes its starting loyalty, which is 5, and you use life to activate its abilities instead of loyalty counters. That being said, its abilities are all good, so having your life go down all the way to 5 in a commander game levels out its power a bit, and its casting cost of 7 too. Bind Liberate is quite literally the cards Bind and Liberate staple together into a split card. Both are good cards, so having them together onto a single card helps with opening slots in decks, so it's definitely worth considering. Wrath of Sod is another crazy card. It bypasses every kind of recovery effect on creatures and just turns them into painless mana confluences. This has so many uses that I could make a video on this card alone. Definitely an interesting card to add in many decks and definitely worth a slot in a commander cube. A good thing is similar to Transcendence is that you lose the game for having too much life. It also has a sort of inverse hexproof where you can't do anything to it, only your opponents can. This means that you can't donate it. The only way to get rid of it is via mass bounce. This gives you about 5 turns before you make 40 life into 1000 life, so you do have some time to work around it. That being said, you can use this to speed up win conditions from cards like Philidar Sovereign or Test of Endurance, so chances are that your opponents are going to want to get rid of it. Kaya Ghost Haunter is a unique planeswalker in that she's meant to not stick around. She can make 2 different emblems that do have to do with her haunting creatures, and her first ability exiles her haunting a creature. You can do all 3 unless you increase her loyalty somehow. I think she's pretty tame, but it requires some working around to really abuse. Bucket List prizes you for casting a card of each type besides Planeswalker. Then, when you mark them all off, you sacrifice the enchantment and draw an additional card. I think this card is fine and works really well. I would use something other than actually marking the card to keep track of it though, like maybe a dice or some markers. How to Keep an Izzet Mage Busy is clearly just for increasing your storm count. This card does literally nothing else. With enough mana, you can just keep recasting this to finish someone off with Aether Flux Reservoir or any other storm card. Since it does nothing on its own, it's not as busted as any other two-card combo with infinite mana. Golgari Death Swarm is only a test card because it's a black-green creature with flying and vigilance. That being said, it's great for those kinds of decks since it's a great beater for its casting cost. Graveyard Dig is great in a black-green deck, but if used in a deck with more colors, you can pay double its cost in order to not be restricted to the colors specified in its effect. Pick Your Poison is a modular spell similar to the Commander 2015 Confluence Cycle. All its modes are good, so this can definitely go into any deck that can run it or into your cube. Start Fire is similar to Bind Liberate, but instead of being two cards into one, it's two halves of two different split cards into one, those being Start to Finish and Fire and Ice. It's not necessarily a bad card, since split cards are like having two cards in one. Seek Bolas's Counsel is a doozy of a card. It's a modular spell, but the mode is chosen at random. Since only one of the modes is detrimental, it's definitely worth it. The odds of getting the first emblem is only about 17%. Since there's 6 modes, you can use a 6-sided die to choose one at random. The other emblem allows you to play cards from your sideboard. In a commander cube, you're undoubtedly going to have a sideboard left over. In this case, being able to play cards from them would only be an advantage if you can produce the adequate colors for them. However, the mode I love by far is the Planeswalking to Pools of Becoming. Since you wouldn't normally be playing Plane Chase, this means that if you're not playing Planes Chase, then you can't Planeswalk away from it and you can't roll a Chaos. This is a card I would definitely add to a commander cube. Smelt Herd Saw is another split card, but only Smelt is one that has existed before. The other ones are new. That being said, if you're still traumatized with Broko Oko, don't play the Herd since it creates 3 elk creature tokens. Saw creates creatures with a new creature type, at least if you're playing with Mystery Booster test cards. Evil Boros Charm is yet another modular spell. If you like charms and modular spells, then this is definitely a good card to consider for your cube. Now with all the spells discussed, onto the lands. Aggressive Crag can definitely be included in a cube or deck since it's a dual land that doesn't come into play tapped. You have to tap it at the beginning of your combat step, so just make sure you use it in your pre-combat main phase. Barry's Land is the realization of long years of myth, legend, R&D, and only now exists since it's not really a card. That being said, if you do choose to include this in your cube, this increases the number of basic land types to 6, so cards that care about that will be affected. It is a basic land, so if you have an incredible amount of funds, you can use this as part of your basic land card pool instead of waste or along with waste. Each one is $15 on eBay as of the recording of this video, so keep that in mind. Gold Mine is another card where you have to mark it, but you don't necessarily have to. You can use a die to keep track of how many markings, and once it has reached 5, it can't give you mana of any color anymore. This is similar to Gemstone Mine, but doesn't use counters, so no proliferate hijinxes. That being said, it's still a land that can produce any color, and those are key to commander decks, so it's definitely worth considering for your cube. Jaskonian Isle is a land creature like Dryad Arbor, but it's 3-4. You have to pay 2 blue to untap it during your untap step. The great thing about it is that you can fetch it with fetch lands. Unfortunately, it enters the battlefield tapped, so you can't use it as an instant speed blocker. Noxious Bayou is something already tried before for Unglued 2, which were the poison lands. They're risky, but it's still a dual land that enters the battlefield untapped. As long as no one is proliferating counters or giving you effect damage, you should be fine. Rift is a land that basically guarantees you don't get mana screwed at the beginning of the match at the cost of drawing one less card. It is a legendary land, so it's something that can synergize with commanders like Kethis the Hidden Hand. Taiga Stadium is a check land, but with permanence instead of lands. It gives mana in a different color than what it's checking for, so this is more along the lines of decks with more than 2 colors. I can see this kind of land being printed in the future, but legitimately in future commander products. Wasteland is technically a different name than Wasteland, so you can run both in your deck. This is a fairer form of land destruction since it basically replaces a useful land for a waste. It's a land token which is done in another card of its subset. So all other interactions with tokens can also be applied there. The other card I've yet to mention is Ral's Vanguard. Back in the day existed Vanguard cards which I feel were like the proto-commander. However, these are all oversized cards and were basically with characters from the Weatherlight Saga. This one is normal sized. This behaves more or less like a conspiracy, but if you play Vanguard, then you should also be able to use this one along with the other oversized ones. So if you include it in your commander cube, draft it as you would a normal card, but treat it like a conspiracy for simplicity's sake. This concludes this flight of test cards from the convention edition of Mystery Boosters. Overall, I have mixed feelings about this subset. I know they wanted to include something special that would only be used in special events, and once these cards are taken home, can't really be used in conventional methods unless the players come up with something such as including them in their cube. I feel like a lot of potential was lost, and they should have just taken more time to design something more rigorous and legitimate. Even if they would have given the cards a gold border and a different back stating that it was just for convention use. I would have loved to see these in an actual border with actual art and with Oracle wording. That being said, these are officially made by Wizards, and I will personally treat any of the ones I can obtain as actual legit cards when I'm able to work on my Commander Cube. In any case, I hope this episode has been informative for you, even though these are clearly my own opinions and views on the cards herein discussed. If you have any opinions or thoughts of your own on these cards, or if I overlooked any other hidden gems for Commander, let me know in the comments. I want to take this opportunity to thank my patrons by giving a shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I also want to thank all those who've liked, shared, commented, and subscribed so far to my channel. My continued growth is thanks to your support. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of A Flight on the Commander Tavern. I am Demented Kirby, and happy theory crafting.